The VAR Show. The one place for your weekly football update.
Hola, very warm welcome to the VAR Show, the show which talks about all the various major football leagues in detail. Today we are going to continue the themes of interviews, and we have a very influential figure and a very inspirational figure in the Indian footballing culture as of today, and hopefully, and definitely, not hopefully, definitely in the future also. We have the manager of Minerva Punjab, Mr. Yann Law. For those who do not know, Minerva Punjab is an Indian professional football club based in Mohali, Punjab. The club competes in the I-League. Since its inception in 2013 as a club, they have won the I-League title once, the Punjab State Super Football League title twice, and were also runners-up of the I-League second division. Minerva was crowned champions of the I-League in 2017-2018 season. We also have our very own Kiran Chemjong, who plays for Minerva Punjab, and he won the title back in 2017-18, and he is also currently playing for them. As for Yann Law, he is just 27 years old and is the manager of Minerva Punjab. Can you imagine? 27 years old and is the manager of such a high profile institution in the country. So wow, that's just amazing. So without wasting much time, I would like to thank Mr. Yann Law for coming on the show. Thank you and welcome to our show. And then we'll move on to our questions. And the first question I would like to ask you is, how are you and what are you doing during this pandemic period?
Thanks, Subhashish. Thanks for having me here. And pandemic here is crazy. You know, 45 days, you've just been at home, nothing much to do, no live football to watch, there's nothing. So we're just enjoying our time with our families, connecting with all our friends, you know, and that's most we can do as of now. So, and planning for the upcoming season as well. That's also very important.
They're scouting players.
Yes, so we are in the process now of looking and rebuilding a team. Because as you know, most of the players, their contracts expire. Some have been sold. Some have, you know, are on a free clause to transfer wherever they want. So it gets difficult at this point of time, and rebuilding a team up to the standard you want it or to the standard of last season what we had, it's going to be a little difficult, but we are doing our best and let's hope for the best now.
So we know quite a lot about you, about your manager career. Can you tell us something about your playing career? Like, you are quite young. Why did you jump into management so young? Like, it's not common. I mean, it's a possibility. You have like the likes of Nagelsmann in Europe who has done that. And you might be the Nagelsmann of India.
Yeah, so I never left playing football. You know, it's a dream for anyone to keep playing. So at a very early age, when I was 18, I just did my first coaching badge. You know, I was literally forced into doing it because there were hardly any candidates in that course. So once I got into those courses, I, you know, actually started enjoying coaching and managing. So in the evenings after I would train, I would go and coach a bunch of, you know, underprivileged children. I really actually started enjoying the feeling of working with groups, trying to develop individuals, trying to develop a team. And, you know, I actually thought, why not? Why not coaching at such a young age? And I just continued my coaching degrees back to back, and I was getting more offers as a coach than I was getting as a player anywhere. So I just started coaching. I never actually stopped playing. I don't mind playing still, but I think I'm doing pretty well as a coach as of now.
So from starting out as a coach in Calcutta United back then to being manager of one of the most well-run clubs in the country, how has the journey been for you?
Oh, it's been one hell of a ride, because when I first did my coaching badge, you know, I was really young. And I was looking for clubs to work in. I was looking for any academy, any camp who would give me an opportunity to, you know, at least get some experience. So I literally went knocking on clubs' doors and asked them if they can give me an opportunity to work, even as assistant coach, as a second assistant, third assistant, anything will do. Just keep me in the club where I can learn, you know. But nobody gave me that opportunity, because each and every club, the players are older than me. So they really did not take me very seriously. So this Calcutta United had actually found interest, and seeing such a young coach, they also decided to make a young team. and they gave me that responsibility over there. So that year, I don't know how we did it, but we won the Calcutta League. And then after that, the offers started pouring in, you know, and I signed a very nominal contract. It was a very small amount, I think around 500 rupees for the whole season. And that's nothing. That's like hardly $8. That's nothing for the whole year. But it was an opportunity. And what you learned from that experience was absolutely priceless. So I don't regret anything over there. And that is my first step of my professional coaching career. And now I'm coaching in the I-League, you know. So a lot of credit goes to that team.
So you were an assistant before you took up the main hot seat job at Minerva. So how different are the roles of maybe an assistant and, you know, like a main manager, like the pressure that come with it?
Yeah, as an assistant, there's honestly not much pressure, but you have to always be there supporting the head coach. You have to be there, you know, handling the players with the head coach. There's a lot of work involved, and it was actually good that I started as an assistant and then went on to become the head coach, because the transition was very smooth, because I understood the functioning of a club at that level. And then when I took over as the head coach, I knew what exactly I wanted. And I could rebuild the team according to the standard I wanted. I got in the players that I knew would fit into my style, my philosophy of playing. And it was really fantastic, because I think if I wasn't the assistant in the beginning, it would have been a tough task this year, honestly saying.
So like, just in a nominal case, how competitive is the I-League? Like,
see, you know, there are, like the ISL, it's fantastic, no doubt. And but there's no pressure of relegation there. But in the I-League, you have a pressure of relegation. You have a pressure of, you know, performing in the highest level. And that's the traditional league that has been running for the past, you know, X number of years. And all the top players have come out from there. It's a historic league, you can say. Clubs like East Bengal, Mohun Bagan are in it. And I think it has more viewerships than the ISL at the moment. So the pressure is immense, because all eyes are here. And me coming from Kolkata was especially a big task, because, you know, I come from the land where East Bengal and Mohun Bagan were originated, and I'm playing against them. So me being a big fan of both those two clubs, playing against them, the expectation from Bengal was also absolutely tremendous. And me being coach at that age, you know, at that stage, was just phenomenal. So the pressure was immense.
So I'll ask you one thing. Like, you mentioned Mohun Bagan, right? And Mohun Bagan, they kind of jumped into the ISL this year after merging with ATK. So do you think, like, so with such a historical club, not only in the context of maybe Indian football, but Asian football, when they have jumped the ship from I-League to the ISL, do you think the publicity of the I-League will be tarnished? Like,
It will take an effect on the I-League, because, you know, the number of fans, the viewership, you know, it is just ridiculous when a team of that stature leaves your league. And even now, East Bengal are in terms of moving out to the ISL. So two teams with the biggest fan following in the country, if they move to another league, you can almost understand what can happen to the I-League. And already this year, we were not supposed to have telecast due to some reasons. But we still managed to get the telecast, because, you know, we have a guarantee of the amount of viewership you can get. But I don't know what will happen next year if both the teams are moving out. I don't know what's going to happen, honestly, to the viewership, because then the stadiums will be empty. There will be no fun to play against, because most of the players, they look forward to playing against these two big clubs, you know, these two giants. And most of the players work hard for it. But now, you know, it's just going to be like any other league. But still with that bit of history in it.
Like, I always wanted to attend a Mohun Bagan versus East Bengal, but for whatever reason, I could never attend. You know, like last year, I was about to attend, but the circumstances could not favor. And now I feel I can never attend, because you'll never have the Mohun Bagan, right? You'll have a, you know, like Mohun Bagan ATK, modern Mohun Bagan. So that kind of, you know, it feels bad, you know, like in terms of maybe Indian football.
So everybody looks forward towards the derby each year, you know, and in the calendar year, you have three derbies. One is the Calcutta League, and two in the I-League. So this year, if both the teams are playing in two separate leagues, then you're going to have only one derby, which is the Calcutta League. And it just, spoils the entire charm of the entire industry, because everybody looks forward to it. Whether you are East Bengal or a Mohunbagan fan or any other club, everybody's watching that match whenever it happens. The tickets are sold out months in advance, and it's really brilliant atmosphere. I've been there a couple of times, and it's just fantastic. Playing in that atmosphere would be another dream, I imagine. So hopefully, I can coach one of those two teams in the future.
Yeah, hopefully we can also play that. Okay, so moving on to another influential figure, at least if I would not say Indian football in Minerva, Punjab, was Mr. Ranjit Bajaj. He has been credited to doing a phenomenal job there, you know, at Minerva. So how was it working with him?
See, he's a football lover. He's an avid football lover. His whole family loves football and he can't live without football. I'll just say, keep it very simple. He is a person who's very honest and on the face. He'll never talk behind your back. So, he does not mind if he comes out on the media or if he comes out on the press, but he will speak his heart out and he will speak honestly. And that's what becomes controversial, But as a human being, he's a gem of a guy. I've worked with him. He's just studying about football 24/7. He invests all his money, all his time, everything on football. If he actually shuts down the club, he can do so much more, but he does not. He's a simple guy. His expenses are to bare minimum because he wants to spend it absolutely all on the club. And whatever you tell him, whatever ideas you give him, he's always, up to listening to it. He's not a owner who will do whatever he feels like. He's always open to ideas. He's always open to players' advice. He's always there for the players. I've seen a couple of games where, not games, but training sessions where maybe a player is down, injured, and before the physio can run in, he's already in the pitch looking at the player, So you don't see owners doing that. You don't see owners in the dugout every single match, and he's found success in everything. He's won the I-League second division. He's won the under 13 I-League a couple of times, under 15 I-League a couple of times, under 18 I-League a couple of times, and even the I-League. So there's nothing in Indian football he hasn't won. And it's all because of that sheer passion he's got, and clubs that are even, 100 years old or have not been able to achieve what he's achieved in the only 4 years of existence that Minerva has had. So I don't think he's doing anything wrong. He's produced the maximum number of players for the Indian national team at the junior and, on the senior level also. Some of the boys are coming up now. So he's just, he's doing a fantastic job. Now he started a World Cup batch, which is the 2034 batch. And he scouted players from the age of 6, and he's going to be keeping them for 10 years and trying to put them into the national team. So he's really he's crazy about football. He has a different thinking, and it was a fantastic experience working with him, because even every day I was learning something from him, to be honest, because he's such a gem of a person, and he just loves football. So working with a person like that, it's just a dream.
So since I am from Nepal, I have to ask you this question. How is it working with Kiran Kemjorn?
Oh man, I think, to be honest, I've never seen a goalkeeper that good with shot stopping, with distribution, clean with his feet, his communication, his leadership qualities on the back. It's just phenomenal. He's a total package. And, most of the teams in any nation, in any country, when you have a limited number of foreigners you can play at a time, nobody wants to play a foreigner in goal, because it's wasting a foreigner spot at the back where you get the least amount of touches or action. So I think we were the only team, actually we and Chennai City, we were the only team who had foreign goalkeepers, because finding good quality Indian goalkeepers are very difficult because they're already taken by all the ISL clubs, So I think Kiran was a fantastic signing. He was, I think, irreplaceable. I could not make him sit on the bench even once. And the day I did, we lost 3 goals. So, he's just phenomenal. Every attack starts from him. He's just, he saved us points. He's been a leader on the pitch. He's been an inspiration to all the young goalkeepers. He's been a guide and father figure to most of the youngsters in the squad. And he's just a fantastic human being. So I think he was the top signing, and I would love to work with him again in the future.
So, you know, like you are so young and you have very influential and maybe experienced people like Sanju Pradhan in the team. Does it become like sometimes do you think are scared of your authority? Like sometimes, you know, they can be overpowering because of what they have achieved in the game.
See, I'll tell you one thing. The moment you step onto the pitch, you are the boss. And I always say that age is just a number. You're never too old or never too young. So when I'm on the pitch, when I'm in the classroom, whenever we're taking video sessions or whatever it may be, that time I'm the boss. If you are here with me, working with me, I'm the boss, whatever it may be. Age is irrespective of the job you're doing. So the advantage for me was always, you know, I've played with these guys before as a player. So it was always easier for me to deal with all of them because they are stars, no doubt, but they have always been like elder brothers to me. But always they gave me that respect as a coach this season, and I respect them highly for that as well. Because without their support, it would have been a really difficult task because, you know, a young coach have problems dealing with a little senior players. So, but they gave me that respect, and Sanju being a captain of our squad really made sure that everybody was giving that same respect to me and I was giving back the same respect to them. So as much as I was guiding them, they were also guiding me. Because, you know, you work as a team. There's no one leader or somebody calling all the shots. So I was always open to taking advice from these players. I was always giving them advice. And that's where the success came in this season, you know. So it was not bad. I wish the season continued because we would have a couple of more points to pick up. But we did really well compared to previous seasons.
So if you had to describe yourself as a coach, like how would you describe your team, you know, like that goes on to play an ideal team, like what you would want your ideal team to play?
See, you know, as a coach, not in modern football, I like the way Bielsa, as a coach of Leeds United. So I try to follow him a lot. I like to keep the ball around. I like to have a young team with a mix of experienced players. And it doesn't matter who you are as a player, I expect you to work on the pitch. Because if you think I'm a star player, I'm not going to defend when the team needs to. Or, you know, I'll only play when the ball comes to my feet. I don't need those players in my squad, no matter who you are or how good you are. Even our top players, I made them sit on the bench because they were not doing what was expected of them. And when they realized that, and when we played them again, they were changed players. And, you know, the game was going better according to the way we wanted. So, as a coach, you always have to keep changing your style, because if you stick to one particular style, it gets predictable and it's easy for oppositions to read you. So we take every game step by step, one game at a time, and we stick to our basic principles but always come up with a little changes so that it's not too predictable for the opposition. And you know, this year every single match I had a different 11. I never had a same 11 who was continuing. Like many coaches like to stick to a particular squad, you know, the core 11 stays the same, or at least 9 players the same. But I never had that. I also played with sometimes a 15-year-old as a striker. We had 15-year-olds playing in the midfield. We had sometimes the foreigners sitting on the bench and Indians playing, more Indians than the foreigners. You know, so I never mind doing that as long as you're working, as long as you're sticking to the system. And whatever the plan demands, you go with that sort of players. It does not matter. You know, you may be the best player, but maybe next game we are going in a different system where he might not be needed. So everything depends on opposition and your style of play. So it's very important to read the matches and then come up with your style or game plan for the forthcoming games always.
So when you set out a team, what do you prefer? You prefer zonal marking or man marking or a hybrid?
See, it depends now on game to game how the opposition is playing. Now, if the opposition is playing with a low block or they don't press too high, then it's no point for us also sitting back and, you know, holding. So it depends exactly on how the opposition is playing. And some coaches, you know, they do a good analysis of the opposition. But when you come to play the actual match in reality, they might also come up with something that surprises you, you know. So reading the game while the game is going on is also very important. You must have a good coaching staff for that as well, who helps you read the opposition. So we can also make our changes, and we should be ready for every single type of opposition and the style they play, because it's important in modern football to be prepared for the worst case scenario, you know, and every single point matters in a league which is just 20 matches. So we have to keep working hard and make sure that it's not like English Premier League where you have 38 matches, you know. So 20 matches, that's all you get, and you pick up maximum points there. So you have to be on your toes 24/7. I slept only 4 hours or 5 hours each day since the time the I-League started, because it's been so hectic studying the opposition, studying my players, planning. It's just, but I love it. It's a fantastic job.
So do you have any coach or coaches from whom you are inspired or you take inspiration from or you follow?
Bielsa is one I like. I like now the way Jurgen Klopp is working. I always like Guardiola, and I always look at Alex Ferguson for his man management skills. And I'm an Arsenal fan. So it's a combination of quite a few coaches, as you can see. And yeah, no particular coach that I would follow in. Or, you know, it's a combination of so many ideas put together and see what suits you best. Because you also have to see what kind of players you have. Maybe I want to play with the possession-based game, but I don't have that sort of player, so I cannot go for that. You know, so you have to make sure that you are ready to have players of various styles and all. And as a coach, if you join a team mid-season, that's the most difficult, because you don't know what you're going to get. And they might not fit your style or whatever it may be. It's always an advantage if you have the squad from the beginning of the season. So there's no particular coach in such, but yeah, I have many coaches I like.
So I have 3 questions left, so we'll go to the third last. That is, do you have any words for any coaches or players who are just starting out?
Yeah, it's the main word is patience. You know, patience and consistency. Don't worry about the money. Don't worry about the opportunities. It will come. As long as you're consistent with your work, honest with your work, and passionate about your work, there's nothing going to slow you down. There's nothing going to stop you. Because I think if I, at the age of 25, can become an I-League coach, I think anybody can do it if they really want it. And it's not impossible. There's nothing impossible over here. Age is just a number. Even for players, it takes time to get a big contract because you have to prove yourself. For coaches, it's even a longer process because there are so many coaches and such few clubs. You know, you start as an assistant, you start as a junior coach, you start working with grassroots or with youth. It's not a problem. I worked with youth for almost 8 years before I started moving to seniors, because when you work with youth as a coach, you can also make your mistakes and learn from them, you know. But with seniors, that there's no place for error because points matter. Every single game is important. So I always say that to the young coaches, be patient, work with youth, make your mistakes, and then slowly build your way up to the senior football. And always it's very important to have a guide or to work under a good coach, because who can review your sessions? Because you might think that you're doing something good or something right, but it's absolutely wrong. So if there's somebody working with you who has good experience, who has good knowledge of the game, who can give you feedback every day, there's nothing like it. So I was blessed to work with also good coaches in my early days. So I also learned a lot, and I never repeated any mistakes that I made. So that's good. And just be patient. That's it. Nothing else. There's nothing going to stop any player from achieving whatever they want, or any coach to achieve whatever they want. It's all possible.
So you are one of the few candidates who are in the, you know, like manager job of a main club. If you combine even ISL and I-League, you know, of the main top teams, do you think the standard of the Indian coaches are not that good?
I absolutely disagree, because I think Indian coaches have tremendous potential, but they're not given opportunities, you know, because the ISL, there was a rule before that only foreigners can be the coach. But I've worked with foreigners, I've seen foreign coaches, and not all of them are good, to be honest. You know, you can't judge a coach based on his nationality. You have to give him his job and let him see how he does. But I think Indian coaches, we are here to stay. We are here to develop the football in our country. And it's always good if you have a guide from outside who has more experience and has worked in leagues better than yours, no doubt. But I think Indian coaches, if you want to develop them, you need to give them more opportunities. Because if they are working so hard and, you know, spending so much of money, and all they do is become just assistants or work with youth, or, you know, it's a demotivating factor for many coaches, and they all start dropping out of coaching. So I think Indian coaches have a lot of potential and they need opportunities. That's it. And clubs need to trust them. You see, in the past couple of years, Indian coaches have won the I-League, but not the ISL, because there's never been an Indian head coach. But who knows, if you put an Indian head coach, he might win the ISL. It's possible. Nothing is impossible over here. And Indian coaches are now at par with any European coach because of, you know, the foreign coaches who came to this country and showed us what is possible in football. And that is important. But now we need to start giving our Indian coaches opportunities, and they will prove themselves surely.
So since you said that you are an Arsenal fan, I could not help but ask you more questions on Arsenal. I just nicked in one question. How do you feel about Arsenal, like the current season and the past season?
It's not going up to plan, or, but it's, you know, it's a phase where one, you know, the change is the only constant. There's a saying, so you cannot always be number one. There are people hungrier. And it's good to see smaller clubs trying to make their way up, you know, and that's fantastic. It's not just only three or four clubs in every league that is the best. Anyone can win it. That's the most important thing. And football is a game, winning and losing is there. But as long as you play good football, that's the most important thing. That's it. You play good football, keep your fans happy, get decent results. Every year it's not possible to win a title for any club. But at least, you know, play good football that people watch. People are looking forward to you playing, not just for you to win matches or get points by, you know, just doing whatever you want. So, like, if you ask anybody if you want to watch a Real Madrid or Barcelona match, everybody would like to watch a Barcelona match because of the way they play, you know. Although both the clubs are giants, both the clubs have a history of winning trophies. So, Arsenal, like, is like that. They like to keep the ball. But now the number of managers, they are changing, and you know, the players coming in and out with the financial state of the club. There are a lot of things coming into factor, which is creating problems for Arsenal. But just stay patient again, and hopefully they win the title next year or the year after that. But as a fan, stay loyal, and that's all.
That's a very long shot from you to win the title next season. But okay, I'll give you a pass on that. Okay, so, and this is the last question. It's a very controversial question. Please think and answer. Which one do you prefer, Lionel Messi or Cristiano Ronaldo?
Yeah, both of them are fantastic, but I would always say Messi any day, to be honest, because he does magical stuff. And Ronaldo also, no doubt. Ronaldo is more about pace, about power, you know, about... It's just two different styles. Messi is not about the power. He's not about the pace. He's just... makes the ball do all the work. So I always think it's always Messi, but no doubt Ronaldo, but I think Messi.
I don't know why, like, I just have a feeling, you know, like people who come from Calcutta, they just like Messi more, like, you know, like, I don't know why. Is it like that?
No, it's nothing like that. If you have a vote, I think they'll be equal, because some people like the way Ronaldo plays, the way he's more aggressive about the game, and Messi is more cool and calm. It's two different human beings, it's two different styles of play. But I don't think from Kolkata you'll have only Messi fans. But I think maybe it's possible, because Messi is more of a cool-headed guy. And, you know, I suggest that would be one of the reasons why he's liked a lot. And not too much attitude or ego. But I don't think Calcutta loves only Messi. And but the thing is, Messi was here in Calcutta to play.
And yeah.
So that match, oh my goodness, it was another atmosphere. I bought tickets in black because we were not getting tickets, but I made my way into the stadium, and it was a dream watching him play.
There was a power cut, I think so, in between.
Yeah. Yes, there was a power cut, but that's how the infrastructure here is. It's not maintained properly. It's coming up, but...
That even was Maradona was there, right? Yeah, Maradona had come.
Pele was here. Messi was here. Ronaldo was left to come. But you're seeing some stars now play in the ISL. Huh? Since the time its inception, big, big players have played in Indian football. So that's a good sign, you know. And now things are saying, the sources are saying that Sameer Nasri could come to...
I heard that. Really Kerala Blasters.
Yeah, so the links are there. Everything is going well. So hopefully in the next 5 to 10 years, Indian football goes much higher. Let's hope for the best.
Yeah. So Jan, thank you so much for talking to us. You know, and I'm not saying this or something like that, but you are really an inspiration even for someone like me. You know, like I had gone to Barcelona to do my diplomas in coaching, okay? And I know few people from India who are my colleagues in Barcelona. And, you know, seeing you there, it's just an inspiration for many of, like, maybe me and who are aspiring to be coaches. So thank you so much for being such a, you know, like, aspirations or inspiration for us. And I hope you win all the possible trophies maybe next year. And maybe you go on to manage Arsenal and take them to the Champions League and win the Champions League, which even Wenger could not do. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Rajesh. Great talking to you, and hopefully also when Nepal football comes up, and hopefully maybe I work there in the future also sometime. Let's see.
Yeah, yeah, you never know. Never say never.
Yeah, it's just one flight away. It's close by.
Yeah.
Let's see what happens, what the future holds. But anyway, I wish you all the best, and we'll stay in touch. Yeah?
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Rajesh. Take care.
Take care.